So when you think of Easter, what comes to your mind? When you think of Easter, what comes to your mind? How about I give you about 20 seconds? If you feel comfortable discussing it, you can. If you just want to discuss it with yourself, you can do that. A lot of times we talk to ourselves. Because there's nobody as intelligent as you, so just talk to yourself. It works very well. Okay, you got 20 seconds. Go ahead. See if you can come up with it. Santos and Jackie are still conversing, but 20 seconds is up, so I'm going to move on. So I'm going to give you my seven. How many of you got seven? Let me see. None of you. You had more than that, that's why. So my first is this. It's extremely spiritual. It's the most spiritual of the seven. It's always cold on Easter, except for today. I can remember we gathered together for family pictures or portraits, and literally you're shivering on Easter. You say, how come it's always cold on Easter? And the second is that traditional greeting. The Lord is risen. Okay, so if I say he is risen, you say he is risen indeed. But if I say the Lord is risen, you say the Lord is risen indeed. So let's try it. The Lord is risen. Yes. And then there's that great hymn of the church. Christ the Lord is risen today. Hallelujah. Now I'm going to date myself just a little bit. It has to be done to a 50 rank pipe organ that the bottom tones are just rattling the rafters. Then you sing, Christ the Lord is risen today. I sound like my dad. He's in glory. I don't want to sound like my dad. I'm going to be in glory before you know it. You know what I mean? Anyway, some of you got that. Some of you didn't. And as a kid at Olivet Wesleyan Church, I looked forward to it every year. We would get candy. This little box of candy, like about the size of a harmonica. And my favorite was this piece of candy that looked like a Reese's peanut butter cup, but it wasn't. It was chocolate with coconut in it. I love coconut. And it was chocolate with coconut, so we would barter, because I hated the ones with that gooey stuff in the middle, like cherries and stuff like that. You know, there was mushy creams. So we would barter, and I'd get everybody's little cup with the coconut in it. That's what I remember about Easter. And then the family getting together for the day. Most stores closed. Can you believe TD Bank is closed today? TD Bank. Hallelujah. They're probably going to count their losses tomorrow, you know, because they were closed today. But now that they're closed, God will honor them, and Monday they'll have a great day. Last but not least is the empty tomb. Say that. The empty tomb. So did any of you have at least one of my seven? Come on. Put your hands up if you had at least one of my seven. All right. About 15%. I'm really curious now what your seven were. So if you'd like to write it down, you can give it to me after church. I won't take time now because my sermon is really long. All right, let's pray. Heavenly Father, what a glorious day this is. A day that we celebrate that the death of the Son of God, God the Son, was not in vain. The punctuation mark that says His death did what no one else's death has or ever will do. Remove the sin and the shame and the stain of our lives from a holy God and present us blameless. Not only take our place, but give us his place. So we rejoice in this day. We pray that those who have yet to step over the threshold from death to life, this would be their resurrection morning. And the church said, amen. Amen. So this morning we're going to look at Easter from a little different perspective. As you know, we are in what we call the wow collection. And the first wow was the origin of sin, which was not, by the way, Satan. He may have brought about the first sin we see on planet Earth, but he certainly, sin did not originate in Satan. The second was, why a golden calf? And the third was A Different Walk by John Kay. And today we look at A Thorned Crown. Say that with me. A Thorned Crown. Now, the origin of this wow moment actually goes back to our first wow, the origin of sin, which, as I said, did not originate with Satan. Contrary to what we often think, the moment we think of Lucifer, we think of Satan, we think, oh, that's where it all started. But it really didn't start with him because he was made perfect. He was blameless. He had no fault until pride was found in his heart. So this word that starts with a P and ends with an E that we call pride, when we say yes to it, we sin. When we say no to it, we please God. I mean, even the most perfect people in the world, by our standards, sin. Like, have I ever introduced you to my 5 perfect grandchildren? Perfect. That's Shiloh on the left, looking just like her Grammy, and Eliana. Now we move to the ornery ones. Not that those girls aren't ornery, I'll tell you that right now. So there's AJ, and there's Eden, and there's Levi. As perfect as they are not so perfect. It's funny, we'll take Eliana and Shiloh for the day, and we're on our way home, and all of a sudden, these two girls that have gotten along all day start bickering and squabbling and fighting. And one day, about the third time we'd done this, I realized, you know what it is? They don't want to go home. They like the fact that Grammy and Pop-Pop take them to the store, let them buy whatever they want, and then take them out to eat. You know, this is kind of a cool day. We don't want to go home. So one day, I just stopped the car. And I said, Shiloh, Eliana, I just want you to know that if this happens again, Grammy and Pop-Pop aren't picking you up. And you won't enjoy this day. Amazing how it all stopped. As it was with Satan, as it was with our Lord, as it is with you and me, sin is a choice. Let us not forget that the scripture tells us this, for we do not have a high priest, it's getting there, who is unable to empathize with our weakness, but we have one who has been, read it with me, tempted in every way just as we are, yet he did not sin. You can't say to God, God, you don't understand what I'm going through. You have never been raised like me. You haven't been placed in my environment. You have no clue why I am yielding to this temptation. Yes, he does. There is not a single thing you or I have ever faced that he didn't face and was able to say no to that we too often say yes to. As I have quoted from this pulpit more times than I could count, 2 Corinthians 5:21. God made him who knew no sin to become sin in our behalf, so that in him, finish it, we might become the righteousness of God. Now that's a clue to why a thorned crown. Put a little dot on your paper, whatever it is. If you have a sermon transcript, you can put a dot on it. We're going to connect the dots. If you don't have one, you can use a little white envelope, put a dot on it, and say that's the first clue, and I'm going to give you a few more. Now, I'm not sure if you're aware, so I share this with you because it serves as an illustration to what we as Christians believe. Mormons believe that Jesus and Lucifer were twins. In fact, they believe, in a sense, we're all siblings, because every human being, every spirit living creature, was created at the same time. All spirit living creatures. So you were created the same time Jesus and Lucifer were created. You just didn't have your body yet. But all these spirits are here. They kind of float until the moment that you become who you are. Jesus was not then, nor is he now, one with the Father. He had a beginning, as does all of creation. However, when Lucifer fell, Jesus, because they were twins, was then exalted to a position above Lucifer, and he was given the title Son of God. And because he hadn't sinned, he became divine in nature at that moment. Now, if that is true, then all the other angels who didn't sin, come on, connect the dots, are also divine in nature. Are you following me? You're saying, why are you giving this illustration? Just hang in there. Like I said, we're going to connect the dots. You know that we believe as Christians that God the Father and God the Son and God the Holy Spirit have coexisted in eternity, eternally. Now, if you're trying to process that, I can't help you. It's sort of like this. This is a quote from Adrian Rogers. Try to define the Trinity and you'll lose your mind. Deny it and you'll lose your soul. See, now there's ways that we can make it palatable. For instance, we say, look, water, vapor, and ice can all appear at the same time at a certain temperature. We are body, soul, and spirit. God is body, soul, and spirit. God the Spirit, God the Son, God the Father. Everything orchestrates from the mind of God, God the Father. But they are three and they function as one. So we can kind of, but what we can never, ever conceive is that this God always was and always is and always will be. I am that I am. He's always amming. He's always present tense, always been present tense. How do we conceive that? Because everything you and I see has a beginning and it has an end. So in our humanity, we interpret scriptures such as the Mormons or the Jehovah's Witness or most of the cults, and we say this just can't be. So then this Son of God has this beginning, just like we have a beginning. It's not what the book tells us. John 17, verse 5. Prayer Ministries edition is page 1229. If you have a Life Application Bible, it's 1774. If you don't have either of those, you can buy one in the bookstore today. It's a wonderful Easter gift. John and Rhonda Miller said amen. The rest of you didn't, but they did. Now, Father, glorify me together with yourself with the glory which I had with you. Finish it. Before the world was. Now go back to John chapter 1, the first four verses. It says this. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Reading with me. The same was in the beginning with God. So in other words, when we think of the beginning, the Word was already there with God. Continuing to read. All things were made by him. So it tells me he was not created. He was not made. He has always been. And without him was not anything that was made. Finishing the read. In him. In him was life. And the life was the light of men. Now you say, well, what is the Word? Who is the Word? Let's look at it. Verse 14. And the Word was made flesh, dwelt among us. And we beheld his glory, the glory as the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. John bore witness of him, and he cried, saying, this is he whom I spoke. He that comes after me, reading with me, is preferred before me, for he was before me. Now hear me. If we were all created beings, including the Son of God, then how could Jesus be before John? Because he would have been created the same time John was created. Because Jesus wasn't created. Jesus has always been one with the Father. He was God as the Son. He was Son, the God. And he's the God, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, who's coming back for you and me. And not only did he take our place, he's going to give you his place. Everything that's his is going to be yours. He didn't build for you some shack in the back of your yard. He didn't build for you some place you could put your lawnmower. He built for you a mansion, man. And if you look at the universe, just think of what your mansion's going to look like. Only God could do that. Yes, and the church said, amen. So, connect the dots. Why a thorned crown? When the Romans brought Jesus out to mock him, they put on him a purple robe, which was symbolic of royalty. And then they brought a crown and they placed it on his head, a crown of thorns. Now, if I'm going to drape him in royalty, wouldn't I put on his head a crown of gold, or at least something that assimilated gold? Because after all, he's the King of Kings. He's the Lord of Lords. He says he is God. We're going to dress him in something that makes him look like that. Why would they contrast, in essence, this irony of putting a cloak of purple on him and yet at the same time putting a crown of thorns on his head? Let me show you it. It's from killing Jesus.
He makes no wonders, but is hailed as king. Let him be adorned as a king.
Purple robe of royal office.
No king shall go forth without a staff. Patience, patience, nothing has been forgotten.
So why a thorned crown? Here it is. The soldiers didn't realize that the crown they placed on Jesus' head was prophetic. See, they looked at a symbol of defeat, but in actuality, It was the gospel. Go to the Sermon on the Mount. It's the paradox of Christianity. They looked at this thorn as a symbol of defeat, and in actuality, they were prophesying that it was a symbol of victory. Why did Satan lose his place in heaven? Starts with a P, ends with an E. Why did Jesus gain and become the name that's above all names? Listen, when we get to eternity, when glory's here in the millennium, although the Father is who he is and everything is under his feet in the sense he is the mind, the orchestrator of it all, the name that is above all name, the name that we're going to worship, the name that we're going to praise is Jesus. Why? Because where Lucifer lost it in his pride, Jesus gained it in his humility. That's what that thorned crown is all about. Look at it. Let's stand. We're going to read it. It's known as the kenosis chapter, Philippians chapter 2. It's Christ putting on flesh. And here it is. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Jesus Christ. I think of my perfect grandchildren. Their mindset is them. It is all about me. And I think that's why Scripture says, hey, when we become an adult, we put away our childish thinking, because when we're children, it's all about me. That's mine. Well, your sister can have it for just a minute or two. It's all right. It's not going to go anywhere. No, it's mine. And then 2 seconds later, they could care less about it. Only when the sister wants it do they want it. See, but we're supposed to have the mindset of Christ, who, being in the very nature of God, reading with me, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his advantage. Instead, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, being found in appearance as a man, everyone now, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Put our hands together and let's celebrate his name. So let me see if we can bring that a thorn crown to where it is Jesus taught and wants us to live. So take a seat, relax. Chuck Colson, President Nixon's aide who went to prison, said, the one thing I could not glory in, God got the glory. And that was his prison sentence. Brilliant man, brilliant mind. Whenever I think of Christ and his teachings, it's always the paradox. It's always the opposite of what we want to do in the flesh. That's what this thorn crown was all about. The world seeing a crucified Christ, one who had humbled himself as the loser, as the one who was defeated, when in actuality he was the one that was victorious. So let me give you some of these paradoxes. I'll say them and you can repeat them. Last is first. Last is first. Getting is giving. Getting is scattering is gaining. Having nothing yet possessing all things. Serving is reigning. Meekness is strength. Humility is exaltation. Wisdom is being a fool for Christ. Freedom is being enslaved to Christ. Happiness is found when it is not sought. Not S-A-L-T, S-O-U-G-H-T, just in case you're wondering. Seeing is trusting what we can't be seen. Rest is being under the yoke of Christ. Smallness is greatness. Yielding is conquering. Losing is winning. So let me see if I can illustrate this. I'm going to bring it like to last week. So my wife, Cheryl, she had been for about a month complaining that she was waking up with a stiff neck and all those accompanying symptoms, not sleeping well, all that kind of stuff. So at the same time, she's telling me she's not sleeping well and, you know, waking up with stiff, pulled shoulder muscles, all that kind of thing. I'm watching these My Pillow advertisements on TV. So I'm thinking, I know what I'm going to do. I'm going to go buy a couple of My Pillows, and I'll switch them out without her knowing it. Just put them in the pillowcases and let it go for about a week and see if about a week later she says, I'm going to say to her, you know, so how are you sleeping, honey? You doing all right? And see what she says. So I bought the firm pillows, and they were there one night. So I took them out, I went back, and I got the medium, and I filled it in. It's about 7 days later. And I asked her, so, honey, what do you think of your pillow? She says, you know, I really like it. And I've been sleeping good. Like, I'm really sleeping good. So when I did this, I'm thinking, I hate my pillow. It's the worst pillow I've ever had in my life. So I did a little post on Facebook and Twitter and everything. I get, ugh, I do not like my pillow. It's lumpy and uncomfortable. This is day 7. It's going back. I'm sticking with an old-fashioned feathered pillow. And there were scores of comments on that post. Now, this was what was so funny. People either loved the pillow or they hated the pillow. There were no in-betweens at all. No one said, oh, it's okay. But what many people said was that if you put it in the dryer for about an hour, put it in the dryer, fluff it up, you'll like it. So I thought, I'm going to put Cheryl's pillow in the dryer and fluff it up. And I told her, you know, they suggest that you put it in the dryer. And she says to me, resolutely, do not touch my pillow. I like it exactly the way it is. But you know me. I'm thinking, I can make it a little better. So I put it in the pillow while she was on the couch. I should say the dryer. And I let it run. And then I put it back. We went to bed. I should say, Cheryl went to bed. I was still in the living room. And I want to tell you, all the fury of heaven broke out. All 10 plagues that visited Egypt visited me. She came out of that bedroom, whoo, I'm telling you, livid. She was so mad at me. I told you not to touch my pillow. Why do you do what I tell you not to do? Now, don't tell anybody, but I had to sleep in the grandkids' room that night. I don't think I've ever seen her that mad. So I actually composed a little text that she was supposed to get in the morning when she woke up. I thought I sent it, but I didn't. But I'm in the grandkids' room. That's on the west side, and she's sleeping in our master bedroom, which is the east side. And we got up, it had to be the Lord, we got up at the same time and we met in the middle. And she had this little look on her face and she said, I'm sorry I was so mean last night. And I said to her, I'm sorry that I didn't listen to you and I did exactly what you told me not to do. And like that, it was all over. You lose to win. Oh, who said I did? Yes, Margaret. I went out and I got her a new My Pillow. Slipped it in the pillowcase. She didn't know I bought it. But after the first night, she said, thank you, honey. You got me a new pillow. And I said, I did. It's the way of the Lord. You know, I could have, and I wanted to say, I was just trying to make it better. People said, that would really fly, wouldn't it? Like a lead cloud. You know? No, it's in losing that we win. It's the way of God. It's the paradox of Christianity. Look, I'm going to give you just a few more. Pardoning removes all offenses. Why do you think God owes you nothing? Because he's forgiven you of everything. See, he's pardoned you. Now the question is, what do you do with the pardon? Triumph is found in defeat. A thorned crown is the royal diadem. And dying is living. It's the opposite of what we think. It's why only God could write the Bible. It's why only God could come up with what he comes up with. Because it's so opposite of how we think and how we want to live and our ego and our pride and our selfishness and what we think is important, what we think is power, what we think. And God's is just the opposite. He displays his power and humility. He wins by losing. He lives by dying. That's what this season is about. Beginning with Christmas, through a virgin birth, going to a cross, cruel crucifixion, placed in a tomb, only to conquer death, sin, and hell, so that all of us could live eternally in Christ. So here's the question. Are you willing to die to your own righteousness and rest in his? Could we stand? If our good deeds could get us to heaven. If in actuality, when we get to those pearly gates and Peter's standing there, you know, this is an allegory, and there's a scale and our good deeds outweigh our bad deeds, and he says, let us come in, why would there be a virgin birth? Why would there be a crucifixion if indeed we could live a good enough life to make it? If the church was sufficient, if your sacrament, your first Holy Communion, your baptism, your confirmation, if that was good enough, then why do we need Jesus? All we would need is the institution. All we would need is the church. They could take care of it for us. But as Pastor John Gaines said at the proclamation, there is no name given under men by which we must be saved other than the name of Jesus Christ. So my question to you this morning is, are you willing to admit, it's an act of humility, that the things you've done wrong, God calls sin, and it separates you from him, he who is holy? Are you willing then to believe that he did something about it in the person of Jesus? And see, commit yourself to his righteousness. Not your grandparents, your great-grandparents, your parents. Not your pastor, not your best friend. Not the church. Him. Embrace him. Let him cloak you in what you could never cloak yourself in. Righteousness. And D, do it today. What better weekend than Easter weekend to give your life to Christ? Be guaranteed new life. This is the best. Can we close our eyes? I want to give you that chance. I'm going to pray a prayer just a sentence at a time. I know that most likely, the majority of you here this morning, you have prayed this prayer. Sometime in your life, you've received Christ. But I suspect, as last night, there are many who haven't. So by all of us saying this together, we encourage those who have never prayed. So with eyes closed, repeat after me something like this. Father in heaven, thank you for loving me. I admit to you that I've done things that are wrong. You've called those things sin. So I acknowledge to you that I am a sinner. And I'm sorry. I believe you sent Jesus, who went to a cross and took upon himself all of those wrong things, all of those sins that I've done in the past, that I'm doing now, and will do tomorrow. Jesus, be my Lord and Savior. Cloak me in your righteousness. Embrace me in your perfectness. Present me to your dad, holy, blameless, without any reproach. Thank you for hearing my prayer. Thank you for loving me.